Welcome to the Engineering Principles class for December the 1st. We have now finished the electrical engineering project, the electrical engineering unit. And so I've graded your submissions. You should see them on Canvas and on Aspire. Remember, the grade that counts is the one on Aspire, not the one on Canvas. And the reason I do that is because sometimes I make adjustments when I transfer them in. For various reasons, like if I'm grading on a curve rather than a straight percentage. Now in your case, I don't think it matters much, but in some of the other classes, I definitely change the grade a little bit when I put it in Aspire. So that's the one that counts. Okay, so we are now finished with electrical engineering. We are going to start into what is probably gonna be the last unit that we'll do before this term ends. And this unit is civil engineering. So for the next couple of weeks, we're going to learn about civil engineering, what it is that civil engineers do, and we'll have a project or two that you'll have to design something and maybe build something. We'll see. If we were at the school, we would certainly have you actually build some sort of a structure. What with this online thing that we have to do, actually building stuff is a little difficult to pull off, but designing stuff we can certainly do. So for sure, you're going to design several structures. And by the way, when people hear the word, or that when they hear the name civil engineering, pretty much everybody assumes, oh, those are the engineers that build buildings and bridges, which is certainly true, but it's only part of what civil engineers do. There are a whole lot of civil engineers out there that do not spend their time designing bridges or buildings. They do other types of things that help our civilization to grow and our cities to exist. A lot of things that people don't think of is, you know, something like just the system that brings water into your house. You know, bring all the pipes to purify the water and deliver the water to your house. And then after you use the water to take the wastewater away from your house and take it to a sewage treatment plant, that's all stuff that's designed by civil engineers. It has nothing to do with bridges or buildings and traffic. Yeah, a lot of people don't realize that civil engineers are the ones that lay out traffic and they figure out how big the streets need to be, you know, how many lanes you need to have. And they figure out the different ways to make the traffic flow better. That's all civil engineering. That has nothing to do with designing bridges. Well, I mean, bridges are certainly going to be involved, but the people who lay out the roadways and figure out the traffic patterns are generally not the people who design the bridges, although they're both civil engineers. Okay, so one of the first things that you need to do, in fact, in your homework tonight, the very first thing that you need to do is I need you to pull out this book that you guys got from the school at the beginning of the school year, and we really haven't been using it. And you may have wondered why we even bothered to get it. Well, we are going to be using it now. So what you're going to need to do for tonight's homework is get out your book and open it up to page 400 and start reading in there about civil engineers. And so on page 400, there is a description of several of the subfields within civil engineering. And so when you take the quiz, because there is a quiz today where, you know, just a simple thing, where you just have to go on and answer questions, much like we've been doing all year long. So the first question on the quiz is designed to see, have you read page 401? So I am not going to talk anymore about the different subfields of engineering, because if I do, then you won't have any incentive to read the book, and I want you to read the book. So you're going to need to read page 401, otherwise you won't know the answers to the questions, to the first question on today's quiz. But then don't stop with page 401. I want you to continue reading and read all the way through about page 406. And what you're going to see that is in those pages, it talks about something that is going to be very familiar to those of you who have taken physics. it's talking about forces and how to take a force that's, if you got one force that's pointing north and another force is pointing east. And so how do you add the two forces to find out what the net force is? Pretty straightforward there. What do you do if you have a force that's going off at some funky direction? Like it's not really north, it's not really east. It's like maybe 30 degrees west of north or something like that. And how do you break it up into the different pieces? So if you're in my physics class, you're going to say, well, boy, this is easy. We've been doing this all year long. If you're not in my physics class, then what we're going to do is new to you. All right. So I am going to assume that we're starting from ground zero because most of you have not had my physics class. Some of you have, and some of you have either had or are taking Mrs. Whitbeck's physics class, but a lot of you have not had anything at all. So we are going to start with the very, very basics of forces and how they work and how you break them up into what we call their components in order to deal with them. So pages 400, or actually pages 401 through 406, do a very good job of talking about this. But because I know from experience that it's something that a lot of students struggle with the first time they see it, I am going to spend the next few minutes talking about it. All right, so if you've had my physics class, well, you can just kind of relax. I would like you to stick around. It's a good review for you. And maybe we'll have some questions that we'll ask you to help out with. Okay. All right, so what we've got here, let me open up a whiteboard. Okay, so if you are a civil engineer, you need to know about forces because a huge part of your job, especially if you're one of the engineers that focuses on building bridges and buildings and structures like that, then a very, very large part of your job is to analyze the forces that are on the bridge or the building or whatever, and see, is the bridge going to be able to withstand all those forces? Or is it going to come tumbling down and maybe kill a whole bunch of people? It's literally a matter of life or death if you guys know how to do this. So let's start with the very, very basics. Let's suppose that I've got some object right here. And there are two forces that are acting on the object. One force is pulling it straight in this direction. And another one is pulling it in a direction over here that is perpendicular to the original direction. So maybe this is north and then this one was east, okay? So if we're in a helicopter above looking down, we see one force that's pulling it to the north and one force is pulling it to the east. Or it doesn't have to be that way. Maybe this is a horizontal force and this is a vertical force. Okay, so I've got one force that's pulling it along the ground, another force trying to lift it off the ground. It could be either way. So just to make things easier, let's just pick one and let's stick with one. So let's assume that we're in a helicopter above looking down. And so there's two forces, one pulling it north, one pulling it east. Let's put a couple numbers on these. Let's assume that the force that's going to the north is pulling with a force of 55 pounds. And the one that's going to the east is pulling with 120 pounds. Now, a couple things here. Those of you that have had physics, let me apologize to you for the fact that we're using pounds instead of newtons. Because if you've had physics, you know that the best way to measure a force is using a unit called newtons. Now, if you haven't had physics, you're not going to have the slightest idea what a newton is. But you should be familiar with pounds. I mean, like if I pick up my calculator and I hold it, I should have kind of a feel for how many pounds it is. If I were to tell you that my calculator weighed 55 pounds, every single one of you should be able to say, no way. Uh-uh. There's no way that a calculator can weigh 55 pounds. But if I told you that this calculator weighed 55 newtons, who knows? I mean, those of you that have had physics, hopefully you guys have a feel for how much a newton is. And so you could tell me whether or not I'm smoking dope when I tell you that this calculator weighs 55 newtons. It turns out, actually, a newton is not very much. Now, a calculator doesn't weigh 55 newtons, but it probably weighs about, I don't know, maybe 15 or 20 newtons. A newton turns out not to be very much. Okay, but engineers, at least in America, engineers don't usually work in newtons. They usually work in pounds. In other countries, in civilized countries, they do work in newtons. But this is Merca, and you know, you got to deal with what you got. So in this class, those of you that are physics students, you know, we're going to have to switch your mindset over, because in the engineering class, when we deal with forces, we're going to usually talk about how many pounds of force it is. And you know, I apologize, but that's the way it is. Okay, so we've got this object here, and there's two forces that are acting on it. So I want to know what is the net force, which is also sometimes called the resultant force. And this is something that you have got to be really good at, because you're going to be asked to do this a lot. Okay, now, so if I just told you that there's two forces acting on an object, let's say that I didn't draw this picture for you. I just told you that there's two forces acting on an object. And I tell you that the first force is 55 pounds, and the second force is 120 pounds. And I ask you, what is the net force on the object without showing you the picture? Okay, so your first guess might be, well, let's just take 120 plus 55. And so it gives us 175 pounds. That would be your first guess. But if I draw the picture, then you can see that there's more to it than simply adding them. When you're dealing with forces, 2 plus 2 does not necessarily equal 4. It depends on the direction. So in this case, you can see what's going to happen is that if I got one force pulling to the north and one force pulling to the east, the net result of that is going to be that the object is going to be pulled kind of to the northeast-ish. Now, the reason I said ish is because if I say that it's pulled to the northeast, well, that has a very specific meaning. Okay, northeast means that the angle is exactly 45 degrees. Okay, so if I say that the net force is to the northeast, that means the angle is 45 degrees. But as you can see here, it's not going to be 45 degrees, because the easterly force is greater than the northerly force. So it's not going to be northeast. It's going to be more east than north. So what we need to do in this class is we need to learn how to do two things. One is we need to calculate something that we're going to call the magnitude of the force. And by the way, magnitude and direction. Okay, so force, anytime you have something like a force where 2 plus 2 is not necessarily 4, because it depends on the directions, okay, then what you're dealing with is something that's called a vector. So a vector is anything that has both strength, which is what we call magnitude, and also direction. So if I only tell you the magnitude, if I only tell you the strength, I haven't told you everything that you need to know. You also need to know the direction. So if you ever have anything like that, then we call that a vector. And forces are a great example of vectors. Those of you that have taken physics, you know that there's a lot of other things that are also vectors too. But for right now, at least for civil engineering, we are going to be dealing only with force vectors. All right, so the magnitude tells how strong the force is. So the magnitude of my eastbound force is 120. The magnitude of my north force is 55. The magnitude of my my net force with the two of them together is not going to be 175. It's going to be something else. So, Zaid, would you be willing to unmute yourself and tell us how could we calculate the magnitude of the net force?
So we first move, to give us a better perspective, we would move the vector that's 55. We could either move the 55 pounds or the 120, but we can just shift it to the end of the point of the 120 pounds.
Okay, so what I hear him saying is that we should draw, even though it's true that both of the vectors are acting at the same point right here, Zaid is suggesting that we should draw them differently. He's suggesting that we should draw one of the vectors first, and if I hear him right, he's saying that it doesn't matter which one you do first. So let's take our 120 pound force first. And now Zaid, when I start drawing my other vector, where should I start drawing it?
Right at the, as soon as the first the vector you just drew at the very end of it.
Okay, so I'm gonna take my northbound vector. So even though it's actually acting over here, when I'm adding them, I'm not gonna draw it there. I'm gonna draw it over here so that it starts where the first vector ended, okay? And so then my net vector, my resultant vector, is the vector that starts where they started and ends where they ended and doesn't care what happened in between. So this is what I'm going to call F net. Okay, it's the resultant vector, it's the net vector. And so Zaid, how would you recommend I calculate a value? How could I come up with a number for the magnitude of my net vector?
You would do 120 squared plus 55 squared. It's equals F net squared, and then you square root the F net to get its true value.
Okay, so you guys know the Pythagorean theorem, right? So this is A and this is B and this is C. You know, the C squared equals A squared plus B squared, right? So if I take the square root of 120 squared plus 55 squared, that will give me the magnitude of F net. It's just Pythagorean theorem is all it is. Okay, so let me put that in my calculator. So I do the square root of 120 squared plus 55 squared. And what I get is 132. Okay, so in this case, you can see that 120 plus 55 does not equal 175. In this case, 120 plus 55 equals 132 because we're not just adding numbers, we're adding vectors, and direction matters big time. Okay, so in your homework tonight, I ask you a couple questions like this. Hopefully that'll be pretty straightforward. Now, before we move on, Zaid was saying that it doesn't matter which one I draw first. So let's see if Zaid is correct on that, okay? So let's suppose that instead of drawing my 120 vector first, I'm gonna draw my 55 vector first, okay? So remember, if you go back here to the original to show you what's happening, what's really happening is we got two forces that are acting at the same point. So this picture right here is a better representation of what's actually happening. But when we add them, it's better if we think about as we take the one vector first. So I'm gonna do the 55 vector first this time. And then I'm gonna do my eastbound vector, which is 120. And hey, what do you know? It takes us to the exact same point. So the resultant vector works out to be the exact same. Doesn't matter whether I do the eastbound first and then the northbound, or if I then do the northbound first and then the eastbound, they both take me to the same place. And so Zeta is correct in saying that. Okay, so we have now successfully calculated the magnitude of the resultant vector, but that's only part of the job. Remember that a vector is something that has both magnitude and direction. So we have not yet calculated the direction. That means we are not yet finished with the job. Okay, now here is where it gets interesting. Those of you that know about sines and cosines and tangents, you're going to find that this is really easy. And all of you should know about sines, cosines, tangents, because all of you are at least in the 10th grade. Now, if you were ninth graders, then I would say, okay, all right, I would understand if you haven't yet heard of sines, cosines, and tangents. But by now, in the 10th grade, you should all know what is a sine, what is a cosine, what is a tangent. All right, so let's just do a quick little check here to see. So I want everybody to type into the chat box in a private message. Don't make it public. I want a private message. So if this, let's see, I keep forgetting I'm in erase mode, not draw mode here. Let me put those back in here. Okay, so if this angle here is theta, so I am going to purposely erase these now. All right, so let's suppose that I'm doing it this way. So if that angle there is theta, I want you guys to tell me, how would I calculate the sine of theta? Okay. Let's remember. So this side here is 120. This side here is 55. And this side here, we didn't know what it was before, but thanks to Mr. Pythagoras, we now know that this side is 132. So I want you guys in a private message to me in the chat box, tell me, how could I calculate what the sine of theta is? And if you have never heard of sines and cosines and tangents, I'd like you to type in the chat box in a private message saying, I don't know what sines and cosines and tangents are. Okay, get to it, guys. All right. Okay, I see several people here obviously know how to do this. Okay, excellent. But I need more people to respond. I want everybody to respond here. Okay. All right, I'm very encouraged by what I'm seeing. Okay, now the person that just typed in your thing, I wasn't asking about the tangent. I was asking about the sine. Okay, so be careful about that. Sines and tangents are different. Okay, I've heard from almost everybody now. And in most cases, what you put in there was correct, but there was at least one person that got sine confused with cosine, or actually one of you got it confused with tangent. Okay, all right, thank you. Somebody was finally honest here. Somebody just typed into the chat box saying that I've heard of sine, but I need a refresher. So thank you for your honesty. I'm sure there are other people who are also thinking that. Okay, so let's see. So who was the first person to correctly tell me what it was? Okay, Juan, you are the first person to correctly respond. So can you just unmute yourself for a minute and give everybody else just a really quick refresher? What is sine of an angle?
I'm not really sure how to explain it. I just remember how do you find it on a, how do you find it? Because of SOHCAHTOA, which is okay. Basically, it's like a saying that people use to remember which side you're supposed to use to calculate the sine or the cosine or the tangent of a certain angle.
Okay.
And
all right. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. So there's three sides to a triangle. There's the opposite side, which was the So as you can see, where you drew the data point, it's kind of like facing. If you keep on going, could you point to the opposite? Yeah. So that's the opposite side of the angle. And then we have the hypotenuse side of the angle, which is like the largest part of the triangle. And then, yeah, right there on 132. And then on 120 would be considered the adjacent side of the angle.
Okay. Okay.
And so with that, all right.
Yeah, okay. All right, so the first step is exactly what Juan just said. You look at your triangle. Well, actually, one thing that Juan didn't say, but he just understood, it has to be what we call a right triangle. One of the angles has to be 90 degrees. If one of the angles is not 90 degrees, then all bets are off. What we're doing is not going to work. Okay, so the next thing we do is we look at whatever angle it is we're interested in, which is, in our case, it's the lower one on the left. So that is the angle we're interested in. Okay, so you guys know what the word opposite means. You know, it means it's way over on the other side. It's as far away as you can get. So which side is as far away as you can get from the angle that we're interested in? Well, it's this guy over here. It's the one that's 55. So clearly that one is going to be the opposite side. Now, what does the word adjacent mean? Well, it means next to. Okay, so if someone was sitting here adjacent to me, that would mean that they were next to me. So if I look at my angle here, there are actually two sides that are adjacent to that angle. Okay, there's this side that we called A, and there's this side that we called C. Both of those sides are adjacent to the angle. So you might think, well, this is a little bit confusing. We really need to only have one side be the adjacent side. So how do we get around that? Well, the way we get around that is by saying that this side over here, actually, it already has a name. The longest side is called the hypotenuse. Okay, so even though the hypotenuse is adjacent to the angle that we're interested in, it's already got a name, so we don't worry about it. Okay, so that leaves us with this side over here. So this one is the adjacent side. Okay, so the most important, so the way that you start then is you say, okay, you pick an angle that you're interested in. So it could be the angle in the lower left, or it could be the one up in the upper right here. If we pick the one in the upper right here, that's going to change things. Okay, but right now, the one that we've chosen is the one down here in the lower left. Okay, so then that means that this is our opposite side, and then the one on the bottom is the adjacent. Now, could we have done that differently? You know, could I have picked my angle to be this one up here if I wanted to? Yes. And if that's the case, if this is the angle I'm interested in, then this is no longer the opposite side. It now becomes the adjacent side. And this one's no longer the adjacent, it now becomes the opposite. But the hypotenuse stays the hypotenuse. The hypotenuse is always the longest side. Okay, so let's go back now to the way that we did have it at the very beginning. Okay, let's go back so that the angle that we're interested in, oh, I hate it when that happens. Let me fix that. Okay, so let's make it so that the angle we're interested in is the lower angle there, okay? All right, so now that we've identified opposite, adjacent, and hypotenuse, I'm interested in hearing more about this thing that you talked about called SOHCAHTOA, but I want somebody else to tell me about SOHCAHTOA. So Gladys, would you please unmute yourself and tell me, what is this SOHCAHTOA? Where'd that come from and what does it mean?
I learned it from math when we were talking about sine and stuff. And so the S, C, and T, that stands for sine, cosine, and tangent.
Okay,
and so then
sine, cosine, and tangent.
Okay, yeah, good. And then the O's stand for opposite, the H stands for hypotenuse, and the A stands for adjacent.
Okay, very good. All right.
And so it basically is, if you were to break it up, it would be sine equals opposite over hypotenuse.
Okay.
Cosine so equals.
Hang on a second. So she's saying that the so in the SOHCAHTOA tells me that sine equals opposite over hypotenuse. Okay. And then what's the next one here?
The cosine would equal adjacent over hypotenuse.
Okay. So the cosine equals adjacent over hypotenuse. That's the ka part of it. Okay. And then what is the toa part of it?
Tangent equals opposite over adjacent.
Okay. So tangent equals opposite over adjacent. Okay. Very good. All right. So those of you who said that you need a little bit of refresher, I hope this is helping to bring everything back. Okay, so my picture is getting pretty cluttered here. So let me open up a new one again. So let's go back here. So we got this triangle where, you know, this is a 120. We know this one's 55. We know this one's 132. Okay, so I want to know a number for this angle. I want to know how many degrees this angle is. And I know that the sine is going to help me do that somehow. So let's see, how about Eliza? Would you be willing to tell the rest of the class, how is it that this sine function can help us to know what this angle is?
So you can do sine of 55, well, sine of the angle. So like the, yeah, that equals 55 over 132.
Okay, so she skipped one step there, but that's probably because she's done it so many times, she doesn't need to think about it. So I'm just going to put the step in there that she skipped. Okay, so we know that the sine is the opposite over the hypotenuse. And so if this is the angle we're interested in, then the opposite side is going to be 55. And the hypotenuse is going to be 132. So what we get then is that the sine of theta equals 55 over 132. Okay, what do we do next, Eliza?
So now I believe you're gonna wanna get like the angle alone.
Mm-hmm. So I wanna get rid of that sine.
So you divide by sine on both sides?
You guys agree? If I've got sine theta, do I just divide by sine on both sides? Is that gonna get rid of it? Ooh, I see some people that are not agreeing with that.
Oh, no. Yeah.
Okay. Like why is that not going to work for us, guys?
No. Wouldn't you have to multiply? Oh, wait. Wouldn't...
Don't you have to multiply it by, like, the... I can't remember what it's called, but, like, the sign with the little negative?
Yeah.
Inverse sign.
Yeah. Okay. So the important thing to remember is that when I look at this, when I say sine theta right here, okay, that is not sine times theta. It's sine of theta, okay? If it was sine times theta, then dividing both sides by sine would make sense. And I can see why it is that so many students do that. And by the way, Eliza, don't feel bad, because that is a mistake that I see students make all the time. Okay, but you need to understand it's not sine times theta, it's sine of theta. So the way to get rid of that sine is not dividing by sine. What we need is we need some function that undoes what the sine function does. It's kind of like, you know, if you've got x squared, if you take the square root of x squared, then the square root cancels out the squared and it just leaves you with x. So that's what I need. So the square root function is the inverse of the squared function. So I need a function that is the inverse of the sine function. And it turns out there is a function. And in fact, the name of the function is inverse sine. And when you look on, if you have a TI calculator, when you look on the calculator, it's gonna say this. So if I do inverse sine of sine of theta, okay, inverse sine cancels sine the same way that the square root of x cancels x squared. Okay, so when I do that, it's going to leave me with just theta, which is exactly what I wanted. So great. But what do the laws of mathematics say? That if I do something to the left side of the equation, I have to do the exact same thing to the right side of the equation. Otherwise, I'm breaking the laws of mathematics. So if I took the inverse sine of the left side of the equation, that means I also need to take the inverse sine of the right side of the equation. Okay. And so now I have something that I can type into my calculator. So if I get out my calculator here and I look and I find the button that says sine, and then up above the sine, I see it says inverse sine. It says sine with a little negative one. Now, if you don't have a TI calculator, if you have one of the other brands like, you know, an HP or Casio, maybe it calls it inverse sine, or maybe what it does, it calls it arc sine. And if you look on your calculator, it'll say A-S-I-N, which stands for arc sine. So that's the same thing. Arc sine is the same thing as inverse sine. Okay, so in order to get here, I'm going to have to push the button that says second and then sine. Okay, so that gives me inverse sine. And then 55 divided by 132. Okay, and now I hit enter and I get 24.6. Okay, so that tells me then that theta is 24.6 degrees. Did I make a mistake? I heard somebody try to say something there. I don't think. I still hear somebody trying to talk. Okay, so I don't think I made a mistake. I think I got it right. So 24.6. And in most cases, you can just round to the nearest degree. So we're just going to call it 25 degrees. Okay, so I'm going to come in here into my picture here, and I'm going to say the theta is 25 degrees. Okay. And so using this, I can then calculate what the angle is. And so now I can finally answer the question about what is the net force. Because remember, that was, it's been a while since we started in this problem. We may have forgotten what the ultimate goal of the problem was. The ultimate goal of the problem was to find out what is the net force that's acting on this object. Okay, so the net force then, the resultant force, is going to be a force that's going off here. And the magnitude of the net force is 132 pounds. The direction of the net force is 25 degrees away from this direction. So if I start this direction and I go 25 degrees to the north of it, then that will tell me what direction the force is. So the way we're going to write that is we're going to say 25 degrees north of east. Because if I start off facing east, I then have to turn to the north by 25 degrees in order to get there. Okay. Now you need to be aware that there is another way that we could have done this. You know, we could have drawn our north vector first and then our east vector. And then the angle that we were interested in would have been the blue angle here. And so then when we do the sine of theta, instead of getting 55 over 132, we would get 120 divided by 132. And when we put the inverse sine of 120 over 132 in our calculators, we will find that that works out to be, that would be 65 degrees, okay? So you'd say, wait a minute, I'm getting 65 degrees as my answer, whereas the other people got 25 degrees. What's the deal? Well, we're talking about different angles. Okay, they were talking about this red angle down here, whereas we, the people who are doing the blue calculations, they're talking about the blue angle. And You'll notice that they add up to be 90 degrees, which is very reassuring. I'd be worried if that wasn't the case. Okay, so when we report our answer is 65 degrees, okay, oops, hang on a second here. Let me clear a little space here. What we need to do is we need to say, is that 55 degrees north of east or east of north or south of west or what? So in this case, if you look at the angle that we've got here, let me switch to black. So if we look at this angle, we see there are two sides to that angle, okay? One of them is a nice pure direction. It's either pure north, pure east, pure south, whatever. The other one is the one that we're interested in, okay? So if you start from the pure direction, which in this case is north, and you want to get to the vector that's our answer, if we start at north, what direction do we need to go? We need to go to the east. So what we're going to do then is we're going to say 65 degrees east of north. Whereas the red angle is 25 degrees north of east, the other angle is 65 degrees east of north. And if you add them together, you get 90 degrees, so you see it works. Okay, so when I give you questions like this on a test, which by the way, I will definitely do, okay? So some of you are gonna tell me that the answer is 25 degrees north of east. Others of you are gonna tell me that the answer is 65 degrees east of north. Who's right? Well, you're both right because they both represent the exact same angle. Okay, everybody good with this? Okay, so now you know how to add two vectors, but we only did this in the case where both of the vectors that we were adding were nice, pure directional vectors. So in other words, what we did was we added a vector where one of them was pure east and the other one was pure north. Okay, so we could do this if the other one is pure west or pure south, okay? So if you're adding vectors when the vectors that you're adding are nice pure vectors, it's pretty easy, just use Pythagorean theorem. But what if you're adding a pure vector plus a vector that's not a pure vector? Let's suppose that this is our F1 vector and this is our F2 vector. And so you see, we've got a problem here. Our F1 vector is a nice pure vector. So we like pure vectors. But this F2 vector is what I'm going to call a funky vector because it is not going purely north or purely east or purely west or purely south. It's going off in some funky direction. So how do you add vectors when one of them is funky? Well, let's see. Zaid, I hate to keep picking on you, but you're the one that took my physics class. You took the honors physics class. So Zaid, help us out here. What do we do when we have funky vectors?
We defunkify them.
We defunkify them, which by the way is a Hendrix term. If you go to any other school and you talk about defunkifying vectors, the teacher is gonna look at you really strange. But here at Ames, that's the way that we call it. So tell you what, let's do. Let's just look at the funky vector all by itself. Let's ignore the other vector here. Let's just say that I've got a funky vector and I'm really nervous because I don't know how to deal with funky vectors. Okay, well, we're going to do what Zaid just said. We're going to defunkify the vector. That means we're going to take this funky vector and we're going to break it up into what are called components. So, in other words, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, what two non-funky pure vectors could I use that would give me the same result as my one funky vector? Well, I can see two ways I could do it. I could take a pure vector that goes to the east and add it with a pure vector that goes to the north, okay? Those two red vectors add up to be the same as that one funky vector, okay? All right. So in your homework tonight, I'm going to give you a couple problems where I tell you what the magnitude of the funky vector is. So let's suppose that this funky vector here has a magnitude of 81, whatever units we're interested in, which in this class are going to be pounds. If you were in my physics class, that would probably be 81 newtons, but it could be anything, doesn't matter. Okay, so whatever units it is, it's 81 of those. And that's the magnitude of the funky vector. And let's suppose that this angle here, I tell you, is 53 degrees. Okay, so knowing that, you should be able to calculate what is the magnitude of each one of the component vectors. So this guy right here, I'm going to call this the X component. And this guy right here, I'm going to call this the Y component. Okay. So if I want to know the X component, I look at this side here and I say, what is the name of that side in terms of opposite, adjacent, hypotenuse? Okay, so I want you guys to type into the chat box. So if the red angle is the angle that I'm interested in, okay, is X going to be opposite, adjacent, or hypotenuse? Okay, I need a couple more of you. Okay, good. All right. Okay, so it's adjacent. All right, so if I know that the 81 here is the hypotenuse, and the side that I'm interested in knowing is the adjacent side, then I ask myself, which one of our three friends is going to help us out? Sine, cosine, or tangent? Well, adjacent, hypotenuse, sounds to me like cosine. Remember? SOHCAHTOA. Adjacent, hypotenuse, yep. That's definitely cosine. That's the one that's going to help us out. So then what I do is I say cosine theta equals adjacent over hypotenuse. And then I replace that with the different values. So either the number or the letter. So I'm going to say the cosine of theta. Well, I know what theta is. Theta is 53. Okay. The adjacent, I don't know what that is. So I'll just call it X. The hypotenuse, yeah, I do know what the hypotenuse is. That's 81. Okay, so now it just becomes a very simple algebra problem. I want to solve for X. So if I've got X divided by 81, how do I get rid of the 81? Well, how about let's multiply both sides by 81. So that cancels that. Leaves me with X equals 81 times the cosine of 53. So when I get out my calculator, 81 times the cosine of 53, I get 48.7. Okay. And so now I know that the X component here is 48.7 pounds. Okay. Now I want you guys to figure out the Y component. So I'm going to sit here quietly. And I want you guys to figure out what their Y component is. Now, some of you are going to be tempted to say, well, now that we know the two sides, we can just use the Pythagorean theorem to find out what the Y component is. You are correct in thinking that. But I want you to get in the habit of doing it a different way. I want you to use our trig functions, sine, cosine, or tangent. Okay, so I will sit here quietly while you guys figure out, give me a number for what the Y component is. And while you do it, I will do it too. And let's see if we come up with the same number. Okay, I'm seeing one number and the number that, oh, now I'm seeing two. Good. And so far the numbers I'm seeing are the same number that I got, so that's good. Oh, the number that just popped up, that one's not right. So whoever put in that last number, I'm not gonna tell your name. Go back and redo it. You did something wrong. Come on, the rest of you, I need to see numbers from the rest of you. Do you need me to start calling out names here? You want me to shame you? Those of you that don't answer, should I shame you into answering here? That's not normally my style. I don't like to shame students. Come on, guys, more of you can do it. Okay, the person that just typed that one in, something went wrong. Try that again. Okay, it looks like you guys are struggling with this. Like, it's a good idea. It's a good thing that we're reviewing it. Okay, so let me go back and see who was the first person to give me the correct answer. That would have been Luke. You were the first person to give me the correct answer. Can you please unmute yourself and tell us how did you do it?
All right, so you're trying to find y, so that's the opposite plus the hypotenuse, which would be sine of theta equals y over 81, and you move the 81 over to the sine side, and then it's 81 sine over 53. It's 81 sine of 53. And then you get 64.69 about.
Okay, so 81 times sine of 53 is what we need to type into our calculator. When we do that, we get 64.7. Okay, all right, so those of you that got it wrong, now you know hopefully what you did wrong. But a lot of you guys didn't answer, so that has me a little concerned. Okay, but all right, so now we know that if we'd have this funky vector, where this funky vector is going off at an angle of 53 degrees and it has a magnitude of 81, that funky vector could be replaced by two non-funky vectors, where one of the non-funky vectors is 48.7 pounds that is pulling to the east. And then also one that's 64.7 pounds going to the north, okay? So these two non-funky vectors together add up to do the exact same job that that one funky vector did, okay? Now, I don't wanna hit you with too much new stuff all at once, although the way that we started here was we started by saying that I've got a non-funky vector plus a funky vector, and I want to add the two vectors. So that's F1 and that's F2, okay? So what I want to do is I want to take F1 plus F2, okay? And I want to know what is the answer. Well, I'm going to save that for next time. Okay. For today's homework, all I'm going to ask you to do is I'm going to give you a funky vector, and I'm going to ask you to defunkify it, which is a Hendrix way of saying what I want you to do is I want you to take this funky vector and I want you to break it up into two non-funky component vectors. Okay. So in your homework tonight, I'll have you do that. But I also will give you a couple problems where I give you some non-funky vectors and I say, add these two non-funky vectors, okay? Because that should be pretty straightforward. Okay, and then next time that we meet, we'll talk about how to add vectors when one or more of them is non-funky. But before you can do that, you first have to know how to break funky vectors up into their components. If you can't do that, then you have no hope of adding them. So I'm going to stop here. I think this is a good place to stop for the night. Now, we still have a lot of time left. We still have a half an hour left. Okay, so class is not over. What I want you guys to do is, I want you guys to open up Canvas. Before you do that, I want you to open up the book to page 400. I want you to read from page 400 to page 406. And then I want you to open up Canvas and do the questions that you'll see on Canvas. And so I'm giving you a half hour worth of class time to do it. If you get started now, and if you're a fast reader, then hopefully you can answer the questions and you'll be done before the class period ends, and then you won't have any homework tonight. But even if you do have a little bit of work left over when the bell rings at the end of the period, it shouldn't be too much. You shouldn't have too much homework. Okay, so if you don't have any questions, you can go ahead and type bye into the chat box and you can log off Canvas or log off Zoom. I'm not gonna make you stay on Zoom. If you do have a question, please stick around. I'll answer your question. And what I'll do is I'll stop the recording first so that you can ask your question without it being recorded. So that way you won't be embarrassed.